Welcome to the 700 Club. Long waits, miles of red tape, and government intrusion. Those are just a few of the problems with Britain's healthcare system.
And now critics say President Obama's plan will bring those problems to America by putting the government in charge of life and death decisions. Jennifer Wishon explains.
I've been very fortunate that I was able to come over here.
When Canadian doctors diagnosed Shona Holmes' brain tumor, she was told it would be months before a neurologist could see her. So she came to the U.S. for life-saving treatment at the Mayo Clinic. Holmes' story and others like it are repeated over and over in countries with nationalized health care. In Great Britain, decision-making power lies with the National Institute of Clinical Excellence, or NICE for short.
Some people call it nasty. That's a favorite joke in England.
Dr. Sikora says it often takes NICE 3 years to decide on cancer drugs already being used in the U.S.
It's a nightmare that ends up with delays. For many patients and their families, a huge emotional sort of waiting area where they're not sure whether they're going to get or not get the drug.
It's known as the rationing of care. Some call it playing God. Governments making decisions on the cost effectiveness of treatments. In Britain, the determining factor is a patient's quality adjusted life year. That is the calculation of the cost of a procedure against the amount of time a person has left to live.
They take quality of life assessments, they take disability, age, terminal illness, for example, is another one, and they will say that that person's life is less worth living than a healthy person.
Here's what would happen in the U.S. under health care legislation moving through Congress. A White House advisory committee would set up a standardized benefit package. The Secretary of Health would then have the power to dictate what services are covered and how often a patient can receive them.
A lot of seniors are saying, what is that? Who's going to make that decision? Is that going to be the president? Is that going to be a bureaucrat or one of these medical boards that they're creating?
Congressman Randy Forbes says seniors denied care would have nowhere to appeal. But one group of Americans won't have to worry.
Congress is excluded from that. Well, why exclude Congress from that? You know, if you think it's good for everybody else, shouldn't it be there?
Ethically, what does this pose any questions for you?
I think we as doctors, and certainly most patients, do not want decisions made about their health care being made by impersonal bureaucrats in Washington who don't know the subtlety of the clinical situation.
Now, groups like the National Right to Life Committee are focused on those they say have the most to lose under the plan.
We're talking the elderly will be most at risk, those with terminal conditions, and they're not going to be given life-sustaining treatment.
The healthcare legislation still has lots of hoops to jump through. Perhaps the biggest hurdle lawmakers will jump will come next month when they're back home answering tough questions about how this would fundamentally change the way healthcare is delivered in America. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
Well, it looks like we're going to have some time to debate this thing. And I imagine there's going to be several versions of this bill before we get into final passage. But I think we do need to underline there's a reason Canadians cross the border in order to get health care here, is that there's more options available. I think one of the reluctance the administration have is to truly make this a care package for those who do not have access to medical insurance, is they don't want to have the perception that somehow this is a welfare program, and they want to call it universal health care because that's the only way the money works to make it happen.
Well, you know, baby boomers really need to be listening to all of this as the blip in the snake, you know, enlarges and they come into their retirement years. I mean, they could be radically affected by this.
Right. What we normally can do to go to a doctor and get options, a lot of people have run through the insurance company saying, well, we don't think this is effective care, so we're going to deny coverage. At least with that, you have some kind of appeal process. If you want to pay out of pocket, you can. Under this new system, will you even be able to do that? And if the government is making the decisions on your care, what does that mean?
Try appealing to Washington for something. We'll all be with Jesus when that answer comes.
And let me underline, Congress has exempted itself under the current. Wow. Congress isn't part of it. Wendy Griffith has the rest of our top stories from the CBN Newsroom. Wendy?
Thanks, Gordon. President Obama says it's okay if the Senate delays a vote on his proposed health care overhaul. That is, as long as Congress keeps working on it. Obama is meeting with Senate Democrats today after they told him to slow down his rush to get the health plan approved. Divisions within the ranks of Obama's fellow Democrats have stalled legislation. Obama says he still wants to sign health care legislation into law by the end of the year. Well, the White House is trying to explain away President Obama's comment on the racially charged arrest of a black Harvard scholar. A white police officer arrested Professor Henry Louis Gates in his Cambridge home. Someone had called the police, mistaking Gates for a burglar. The officer says Gates refused to show ID and acted disorderly. President Obama says the police officer acted stupidly. But a White House spokesman now says the president was not calling the officer stupid. Turns out the officer actually serves as a racial profiling expert. A black police commissioner appointed him to that position. Still, Bishop Harry Jackson tells CBN News racial profiling is a problem in that area.
I believe the history of Cambridge, if you've lived there as I have and know anything about the area, has racial tensions existent right now, and that it's a problem that has to be addressed. And if this kind of thing can happen to a well-known Harvard professor, heaven help some of the rest of us in anywhere USA.
The officer's friends and co-workers, both black and white, all hail him as a principal cop and family man who is being unfairly described as a racist. A federal corruption investigation in New Jersey has put five rabbis, three city mayors, and dozens of other public figures behind bars. Investigators arrested the men on major corruption charges, including international money laundering. Some of the other 44 people arrested include state legislators and city council members. Investigators say the ring laundered tens of millions of dollars through charities controlled by the rabbis. The rabbis were also charged with trafficking human organs from donors in Israel, as well as selling fake designer handbags.
The fact that we arrested a number of rabbis this morning does not make this a religiously motivated case. Nor does the fact that we arrested political officials make this a politically motivated case. This case is not about politics. It is certainly not about religion. It is about crime, corruption. It is about arrogance. It is about a shocking betrayal of the public trust.
The FBI says it has been investigating this crime for over 10 years. An American-born al-Qaeda recruit is turning out to be one of the government's most valuable assets in the war on terror. Authorities captured 26-year-old New Yorker Bryant Vinnis last year in Pakistan. He trained there as a suicide bomber. Investigators say he's now giving inside information on the day-to-day operations of al-Qaeda. He's also revealed several potential terrorist targets across Europe. The troubled African nation of Somalia is once again at risk of falling into the hands of Islamic extremists. The capital city of Mogadishu is considered one of the most dangerous cities in the world. And as Dale Hurd reports, violence there is increasing almost daily.
Mogadishu has once again slipped into anarchy. African Union peacekeepers, along with a small Somali government force, on the front lines of a battle to try and save the city from falling into the hands of the al-Qaeda-backed group called Al-Shabaab, which means the youth. And by all accounts, the youth are winning. Al-Shabaab now controls three-quarters of Mogadishu. The presidential palace is under heavy guard and endures regular mortar attacks. The president, Sheikh Sharif Ahmed, is rarely able to leave and is more like a prisoner in his own palace.
The government is conscious of the situation. This is a young government with very limited financial means.
Two French security agents were taken from this hotel last week. Al-Shabaab has also beheaded at least seven Christians. Reuters reports the group accused the Christians of spying and abandoning Islam. Some are calling for more African Union troops with a broader mandate, but there's no longer any peace for these peacekeepers to keep, and that has their commander frustrated.
I don't think we can sit and watch as armed opposition groups are building up, and wait until, you know, they attack you and overrun you.
This has rapidly become a proxy war, with American arms pouring in to support the government and al-Qaeda-linked Arab and Pakistani jihadists fighting with al-Shabaab. Somalia has not had a functioning government for 18 years, and now al-Shabaab has brought with it Islamic Sharia law and even more chaos. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Thanks, Dale. It's being hailed as a major advance in stem cell research, and it doesn't involve destroying embryos. Teams of Chinese scientists managed to produce live mice from stem cells taken from the skin tissue of adult mice. That's according to studies published in two journals. A leading stem cell researcher says the new type of stem cells could replace the need for controversial embryonic stem cells. And just in case you were wondering, you can now use Twitter to send your prayers to the Wailing Wall. Over the centuries, people have placed their handwritten petitions between the wall's ancient stones. In recent years, the faithful could actually fax or email their prayers. And now, the Western Wall has its own address on the social networking service Twitter. People around the world can tweet their prayers, have them printed, and placed in the wall. And I guess God will still hear those if they come from, if you tweet them. Right, Gordon?
Well, I assume it's a human being typing them in, so, you know, he hears all his children. But the technology has really gotten interesting. You know, I believe in chat prayers.
There's new meaning to the term, you can write on my wall, right?
Yeah, we've been doing some, you know, some wonderful things with the internet in the past year,
yes,
with
a
spiritual gifts class on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday nights, and then the new interactive show, 700 Club Interactive. And what we're finding is within the chat room, there's this wonderful community developing where they're praying for one another and God's responding and healing the sick in the chat room because of chat room prayers. So
and
it's
anybody's
wonderful.
Invited, right?
Anybody's invited.
Anybody and everybody. So, coming up, follow a real-life Indiana Jones on the hunt for the Ark of the Covenant.
It rested right in where those trees are. We're going to go by it here right now. You're going to see where they actually say the Ark sat in a tent.
Why this explorer believes the Ark rests in Ethiopia. That's next.
In this box is what I need to control my diabetes, to stay healthy, and get on with my life. It comes from Liberty Medical. And now, it's not only where I get my diabetes testing supplies, but it's where I get my prescription drugs as well. See, if you're on Medicare, the cost of your diabetes testing supplies, as well as your prescription drugs, may be covered. Liberty takes care of all the paperwork with Medicare and sends the prescription forms directly to your doctor for approval. Then on your schedule, packs up this box and sends it right to your door with no charge for shipping.
Liberty assures you have everything you need to manage your diabetes, including most brand name meters. Call now and we'll send you a free meter, plus a free cookbook when you join.
Call Liberty. They can help you live a better life.
Call 1-800-407-4790. 1-800-407-4790.
Next week, a tale of Olympic triumph.
Nobody believed that I was going to win.
And defeat.
There I lay in front of 30,000 people, and basically the dream ended there.
The hardships along the way.
I was, at one point, in hiding to keep from being killed.
And why neither of them would change a thing.
When I crossed the finish line, I could hear her voice. Take it, Jesus! That's my baby!
Monday, on the 700 Club.
The biblical Ark of the Covenant has been missing for thousands of years, and many have tried to unravel the mystery. Some claim it's being held in Ethiopia, so Chuck Holton went looking for evidence on the trail of the lost Ark.
The Ark of the Covenant, built by Moses to hold the stone tablets of the Ten Commandments at the command of God Himself. In Jerusalem, it was the literal dwelling of the Most High, secreted in the darkness of the Holy of Holies for centuries. Then it disappeared. No one knows exactly where or when, but for more than 2,000 years, the whereabouts of the Ark have been shrouded in mystery, despite countless attempts to track it down. There are many theories as to the whereabouts of the holy relic. Some say it's buried under the Temple Mount. Others contend it was carried to Egypt before being lost to history. Wherever it may be, the Lost Ark of the Covenant has become one of the most sought-after Christian relics in history. On a recent trip to Africa, I met up with explorer Bob Cornhook, founder of the Bible Archaeology Search and Exploration Institute. He's been investigating a little-known theory about the Ark for over 10 years and agreed to let me tag along on another fact-finding adventure. A former crime scene investigator in Los Angeles, Bob has made a name for himself by searching for biblical relics based on the same techniques he used in law enforcement. Taking the Bible as a literal guide, he's traced the route of the Jewish Exodus from Egypt, searched for Noah's Ark, and probed the mystery surrounding the true location of Mount Sinai. His Ark theory goes like this. Just before the Babylonians invaded Jerusalem in 586 BC, Levitical priests moved the Ark to Egypt to save it from being destroyed. After more than a century there, it was moved again all the way up the Nile River to Lake Tana in Ethiopia.
This is where they say that they had the Ark and it rested right into where those trees are. We're going to go by it here right now, and as we go by with the boat, you're going to see where they actually say the Ark sat in a tent, very similar to the tabernacle in the wilderness.
The monks living on Tanakirkos Island haven't changed their worship or way of life for thousands of years. Even today, they dress in animal skins and live a primitive existence farming the small island. They also spend more than 3 hours a day in prayer. The monks showed us relics that they say arrived with the Ark.
So these implements were said to be brought with the Ark from Solomon's temple. And this is the gomer that sits down, they put the blood in it, and then they would sprinkle the blood upon the Ark.
According to these men, their ancestors safeguarded the Ark here for 800 years.
In that time, Ethiopia became a Christian nation. And after that, the king came and retrieved the Ark and took it to Aksum, where we're going next.
The city of Aksum in northern Ethiopia was once the capital of the kingdom. Ancient kings built giant obelisks to mark their graves, which rival the pyramids in engineering genius. Legend has it that the Ark was brought here in about 400 AD and was placed in the church of Our Lady Mary of Zion. The only man allowed to see the Ark is a monk called the Guardian, who's never allowed to leave the church enclosure.
It's like a bunker. It's made out of cinder blocks, and they tell me that as you go in that door, that there is a corridor that goes to the left, then there's a corridor makes a sharp right turn, and then another sharp right turn coming back to where what they claim is the Ark of the Covenant, sitting in a big stone sarcophagus box with a silver ornate inlaid sleeve. So people say, why doesn't someone go in and get it? It'd be pretty hard to bring it out because they actually built the building around this object that they call the Ark of the Covenant.
We arrived in Aksum on the holiest day of the Ethiopian Orthodox calendar, the Festival of Timkat. It's a day when tens of thousands of the faithful make a pilgrimage to Aksum, and a replica of the Ark is brought out of this church and paraded through the streets of the city. The people sing and dance before the procession, and the party lasts all night long.
Timkat is like Easter and Christmas all wrapped into one. This is their festival of the Epiphany, their most important holiday of the year. And these women will be out here all night long, worshiping, singing songs, and praying. There's no doubt that this is a special place and a special time.
The next morning, these revelers continue celebrating with songs and dances that haven't changed in millennia. It's a fascinating look into Old Testament-style worship that can't be found anywhere else in the world. At the end of the day, there's no way to know for certain if the Ark is here or not. But one thing is for sure, there's no doubt whatsoever in the minds of these Ethiopian Christians.
Do I personally believe it? I don't know. I believe they either have the actual Ark of the Covenant mentioned in the Bible, or they have a replica that is so convincing that they believed it to be the Ark of the Covenant for more than 2,000 years.
Chuck Holton, CBN News, Aksum, Ethiopia.
Well, I think the debate's going to go on for a long time as to exactly where it is. Jeremiah, according to the Bible, Jeremiah hid it away, and then he prophesied, there will come a day where you won't even remember it anymore. And some rabbis have taken that to mean that we shouldn't even look for it. So where is it? Is it off in a desert place in Jordan? Is it on the Temple Mount? We don't know. Some believe that because it was made of wood, there is absolutely no way it could have survived. And some also believe it was destroyed by the Babylonians when they sacked the temple. Is it possible it's in Ethiopia? Maybe. But when you look at the implements, and I've actually asked people, well, why hasn't anyone tested the implements that they do show? They don't show the ark. What about the implements? And is there any dating method? And can you examine the tool work? And is it similar to other examples that you can find in archaeology in Israel? And the answer comes back, well, it's not even close. So that would mean it's not there.
Fascinating story, though.
It's a great story, and it's a great cultural. You know, when you look at the tradition associated with it, you go, yay.
Yeah, it's wonderful. Well, people have been looking for years, and will continue to do so. Up next, what do an American boy and a Russian soldier have in common? Find out right after this.
Pat Boone here from my good friends at Swiss America, the company that's helped Americans to rediscover gold for over 25 years now. You may have noticed gold prices have more than doubled in the last 5 years, but you ever wonder why? Economists say the top five reasons are a falling dollar, which also creates number two, a rising cost of living. Third, increasing demand for gold worldwide. Fourth, political uncertainty. And fifth, new Wall Street gold funds. It all adds up to higher prices ahead. Gold offers safety first and then profit. A wise economist has said, a portfolio without gold is like walking around naked in 0-degree temperatures. So don't get caught in the cold without gold. Call Swiss America now for a free educational kit. Ask about tax-free gold IRAs. Seize this rare opportunity today. Call now.
Every year, thousands of Americans will fall in their homes. Every year, thousands of house fires will start while its occupants are away. Now, protect yourself and your home with Alert USA. For just pennies a day, you'll get an advanced personal alarm system that, with the push of a button, connects you to our emergency response center. Act now and get a quality smoke detector that connects to our monitoring station. So, with Alert USA, you're protected when you're home, and your home is protected when you're not home. For a free brochure, call now.
In 1981, CBN launched an animated program in Japan to teach children the Bible. That show, Superbook, was a rousing success. So CBN decided to use Superbook to preach the gospel around the world, even behind the Iron Curtain.
When the Russian language version of Superbook began airing in the former Soviet Union in the early 90s, no one expected the reaction it would get. Millions of letters and children's drawings flooded into the CBN offices as the series aired in prime time each week on the national channel. We recently visited a town in Ukraine and were surprised by the number of people who still remembered it, the show from so long ago.
Superbook. I remember something about this. I remember watching the story of Noah's Ark. I watched this as a child. The cartoons gave us something positive to think about our lives. It helped us to know about religion and faith.
It is an excellent and professional program. It brings positive things to life.
And this is Vitaly Stebanov. He's the children's programming director at CBN's TV studios in Ukraine. 20 years ago, after serving in the Soviet Army, Vitaly became one of millions whose lives were changed through Superbook.
Through Superbook cartoon, I repented, and he brought me to be a part of Superbook Club TV program. Really, Holy Spirit anointed this cartoon. That's why many people started to watch this and was seeking about the real truth for their life.
And Vitaly's wife Ludmila says Superbook was the way many Russians were introduced to God after years of communist rule.
Adults and children as well, they all watched together since it was the only one way for them to know more about Bible and God.
Now in 2009, CBN plans to reach the next generation of children with the truth of the Bible as we release the first episode of the remake of an old classic.
Bow down upon beast, O Israel!
Nothing can save you now. Your God can do nothing for you.
In this first episode, the young shepherd boy David faces Goliath, the enemy of Israel.
No! Thou is the Lord! You will not strike me today!
You're going to die.
It's an animated series of the Bible for a new generation, and it's happening thanks to you.
When this aired, starting in the 80s, millions of children and their families responded. I mean millions. It was unbelievable. We were overwhelmed with the mail that we got. Today, there is an amazing opportunity to take the truth that was in the original Superbook and use it around the world to touch the lives of kids. That's what we're finding out. I was just in Nepal, where we have a children's program there, and what we see is that when kids are touched by truth, they take it to their parents, and then the parents and the children wind up in the local church. It's an amazing thing to see the power of video. And we are doing that right now with the new Superbook. This, the giant adventure you just saw a little bit of there, is the very first episode of what will be the entire Bible. And we want to ask you to help us do this so that we can take it not just to the area of the world that used to be under communism, but really around the world. Many, many people have still not heard the message of the love of Jesus Christ. And we want to do the whole Bible on video in this wonderful 3D format. And so we're asking you to be a part of that today. Will you help us with that? With a gift of $25 or more, you can do that by sending your gift to CBN.com. You can go on, register online, or you can call us 1-800-759-0700. And for those who give, we're sending out this first edition. Is that right?
That's right.
You can actually
get a copy
see it
of the
for
pilot.
Yourself and your kids. But it's very exciting. I mean, this is a project that's going to have huge impact.
This is a project that literally will CBN's going to be doing for the next 10 years, where we want to educate a whole generation in the Bible stories. And we saw the success the first version had, and in trying to distribute it around the world, we had television stations ask us, can you update it? Can you make it look modern? Can you come in and reimagine Superbook? So that's what we're trying to do, but we need your help to do it. The cost for just the first series, which will be 13 episodes, we're going to start in the Garden of Eden and end when Jesus comes back. And focus in on the stories, the prophecies of Jesus in the Old Testament. Three of the episodes are going to be on the birth, the life, the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We're going to show the story of Paul and his conversion, but we need your help to make it possible. Each episode costs around $500,000. That's a lot of money to do. So this is a $6 million project. We need your help to make it possible. So call us, 1-800-759-0700. Well, we've released the new version of Superbook, and it's teaching kids more than just the Bible story. It applies that story to modern-day situations, and it helps kids learn valuable life lessons, just like the boy you're about to meet.
Cherie and John Gregory describe their 6-year-old son, Joel, as fun and outgoing. So when it was time to sign up for their church's Easter program, they were sure Joel would jump at the chance. There was just one problem.
He has a fear of standing in front of a group of people and performing.
Joel had his own words to describe how he felt.
Frightened, terrified.
Although John and Cherie tried and tried to convince him that it would be fun, Joel would have no part of it.
The other kids practiced for 2 months and I refused.
About that time, Joel and his sister Selah started watching Superbook. Joel loved watching the Superbook characters Chris, Joy, and Gizmo.
We put it in, and he watched it over and over and over, and so did our daughter Selah. And they watched it probably 50 times that first week, at least.
Pretty soon, he memorized the whole episode word for word. That gave John an idea.
We were watching it one day, and my husband turned to Joel and he said, "Look, Joel, Chris was afraid to perform, but what did David tell him?" And Joel said, "He said that he should do it for God." And my husband said, "That's right. you shouldn't be afraid of performing, because if you're doing it for God, there's nothing to be afraid of.
Then on Easter morning, a child decided to drop out of the program.
The children's pastor walked up to my wife and said, Joel wants to perform. And then he told us that he wanted to do it for God, and he's not going to be afraid.
My husband and I cried because we knew how much courage that was taking for him to even say that.
After only 10 minutes of practice, Joel performed his part perfectly. Joel says watching Superbook taught him not to be afraid and to trust God.
We just started watching Superbook and Jed just encouraged me.
That is what this pilot program did for that little boy. If you want to be a part of producing the whole series, just imagine what the whole series could do. We tell the story of creation from Eden all the way to when Jesus comes back in 13 episodes. What can that do? How can that teach kids around the world the Bible stories, the good news, and do it in a way that's watchable? Those children in that story watched it 50 times in a week.
Yeah.
I feel sorry for the parents, but the message got through, and the message changed their life. I mean, it gave him boldness.
But, you know, one of the things about a project like this that is so awesome is, though it's costly to do it, it's the gift that keeps on giving. I mean, there's no end to how it can be used and where it can be used. So it's really an amazing tool.
Well, once we're done with the first 13, and this is not some short-term thing, you're not going to see it come even in the next year. It's going to take 2 years to finish it. That's the level of detail and the level of quality we want to achieve on the series. But once it's done, we're going to have it in Hindi and Mandarin and in Bahasa Indonesian, Arabic, Spanish, French, as well as English. So we want to blanket the world with Bible stories, and you can be a part of it with your gift of $25 or more. So call us, 1-800-759-0700, or you can log on to CBN.com. When you log on to CBN.com, we encourage you to join up with our new social network. It's called my.cbn.com. In there, you can create a page, and we have something called missions, and Superbook is one of the missions. And if you can see on the there on that mission Superbook, you can adopt Superbook as one of your own missions and start raising money for that, and encourage your friends to give as well and tell them the story. And we're already seeing Dallas in a couple of weeks. They're going to have a Superbook party. I love the inventiveness of this. They're renting out a theater. They're inviting their friends. They're going to show the Superbook episode in high definition and encourage people to get involved. So if you want to do something, I mean, the reports in America about biblical illiteracy are shocking. Where this generation coming up in America doesn't know the Bible stories, and they're not going to Sunday school. How can we teach them the Bible in a way that they will receive and understand and actually enjoy?
You know, here's another creative thing that people are doing with that. I've heard that there are some people who are celebrating major things like a birth of a child or an anniversary or birthday and saying, instead of giving gifts, would you become a part of my network of people supporting this project and give to this project? You can actually track how your friends are joining with you on the site. It's awesome. It's awesome. So be a part of it. You don't want to miss out.
Okay.
Well, up next, he was a drug addict, a thief, and an ex-con. And he's drawing thousands of teens to stadiums across America. Find out why when we come back.
CBN presents Superbook for a new generation. Now reimagined from the classic CBN cartoon, a new series featuring amazing Bible stories brought to life using state-of-the-art animation.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Your kids will love being entertained while they learn biblical values like courage, loyalty, humility, and faith as they join Chris, Joy, and Gizmo in their travels through time. In the first episode, A Giant Adventure, Chris and friends land in ancient Israel, where they meet David and witness his fierce battle against the giant Goliath.
You come to me with sword and spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts.
Your gift of $25 or more will help create future Superbook episodes. As our thank you, you'll receive a special edition DVD of the first episode and our brand new Superbook trading cards. Give your child the advantage of learning God's Word. Superbook, superpower to change your life.
As
co-host of the 700 Club, I see incredible stories of God's faithfulness to our viewers every day. It builds our faith to see what God is doing in people's lives. Perhaps you've seen a miracle in your finances. We'd like to share your story with others so that they too can be encouraged. Please call 1-800-759-0700 or log on to cbn.com. We want to hear from you. Your life can inspire others.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. Traditional foes in the abortion debate say they're teaming up to reduce the need for abortions. Pro-choice groups Planned Parenthood and NARAL, along with pro-life figures like Pastor Joel Hunter of Northland Church in Florida, are endorsing a new bill. It calls for comprehensive sex education, increased access to contraception for low-income women, and a national adoption campaign. Concerned Women for America President Wendy Wright tells CBN News abortion opponents should not be fooled by this proposal. She says the goal is to funnel more taxpayer dollars to groups like Planned Parenthood, the largest abortion provider in America. No Republicans are publicly supporting the bill. Well, dirty water is one of the biggest sources of disease in third world countries. Millions die each year of parasites, typhoid, and other water-related illnesses. CBN's Operation Blessing is doing what it can to save some of those lives, partnering with Water Missions International. The aid organization recently installed two water purification systems in Nigeria. The villagers used to rely on contaminated ponds and open wells for drinking and bathing and watering their cattle. The new wells now bring clean drinking water to thousands of villagers. Operation Blessing teams are planning to install six more systems throughout the world this year to help other communities in need. And you can always go to Operation Blessing's website to get the latest. It's ob.org. Gordon and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
The doctor came in. I was still waking up from anesthesia. He leaned over my bed and he said, "Laura, you have cancer." And he walked out of the room. The first thought is, what's going to happen to my children? I knew I was ready to fight this, and I just wanted this cancer out of me. I wanted to take care of it and move on. Then my mom called me. She had seen an ad on TV for Cancer Treatment Centers of America. It was just a tremendous experience from the minute that I walked in the door. Their bedside manner, you just can't even describe it. It takes a very special person to do what they're doing.
Hope is alive at Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Call us now to have a real conversation about you and your treatment options. We'll send you this free DVD that shows you how this very special group of people put you at the center of everything they do.
I wanted to live to see my kids grow up. That's what gave me the drive to fight cancer. They supported that in me. They gave me choices. They made me realize that every life is worth saving. You can't fight cancer if you don't have hope.
Joseph Rojas was a drug addict who stole money from his family to get high. He was in and out of prison and nearly died of an overdose. Joseph wasn't exactly the ideal role model, but his story is changing the lives of thousands of teens. You're about to see why. God promises you that. I love what he said, you may have made some mistakes, but your life isn't lost. It's not worthless. Early on, he said, how could God love me? Just a drug addict. You know, the Bible says that it likens Jesus to a shepherd, and it says, though he has the whole flock with him, if one is lost, if one is out there alone, away from the flock, he leaves all of the flock that are with him to go out and find the one. And he carries that little lamb back on his shoulders until he brings it back to safety and places it in his family of sheep. Maybe you're that little lamb today. Maybe you're out there. You know when you're out there. Joseph knew he was out there. He just couldn't figure out how to get back. And you know, sometimes we feel like we have to do that. Like, I have to figure out how to do this. I have to get myself cleaned up. I have to come to a place where I'm acceptable to Jesus. You know, Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. I was lost. Are you lost today? Don't try to save yourself. If we could do that, we wouldn't have needed a Savior. Don't try to clean yourself up. Jesus does that. Don't try to get good enough. It's not possible. We are sinners, and we are in need of a Savior. And God, your Father, loved you enough to send his only Son who was without sin, but who was willing to come and pay the price so you and I could be forgiven, have relationship with God, and even have eternal life. All of that's available. How do you get it? You ask. You do what Joseph did. You say, Jesus, I have come to the end of myself. I need you. I can't get out of here. I don't know how to crawl up from this pit that I'm in. Today, God sees you. You see, he searches us out. He wants us. His desire is to be with us, to love us, to have relationship with us, to rescue us from our own undoing. Today, will you receive God's love, his forgiveness? That's part of the package, you know. The amazing thing about our God, he doesn't just forgive what we've done. He forgets it. Where else do you find that? Will you pray with me right now? Open up your heart. Open up your arms and receive the love of God today. Let's pray. God, I want what Joseph's got. I need you. I have blown it so many times, not once, but many times over. I know you know it all. I want you to know I recognize it all. And I am so sorry for everything. Today, I'm asking you to take what's left of my life, to change me, and then to use me. I don't understand why you want me, but I want you. I accept that you love me. I accept your forgiveness today. I accept a fresh beginning. Oh God, fill me with your Spirit. Teach me your ways. Be the Lord of my life and the Savior of my soul. I want everything you've got to give, and I want to give you all of me. So today, I make this great exchange with you. All of you for all of me, for all eternity. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, you started the journey. What do you do now? We've put some materials together to help you grow in your relationship with God, because this is just the beginning. This packet's called A Higher Calling, and it's absolutely free. It's filled with a message for you from the Word of God. If you call 1-800-759-0700, just say, I just prayed that prayer, and I'd like the Higher Calling packet. Or you can log on to cbn.com and receive it that way. But call or log on today. Jesus Christ loves you, and you have a whole new life before you. Gordon?
Well, up next, walking on eggshells wasn't just a figure of speech for Glenda Jones. That's how it felt every time she took a step.
I tiptoe. because the heels hurt so bad. I just kind of tiptoed through the house, kind of holding on to balance myself. I really knew it hurt, but I didn't know, you know, what to do about it.
Watch her pain vanish without the help of a doctor.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
These are the most powerful songs of our time.
Now is the time to worship.
And now, for the first time, the biggest praise and worship songs are together.
How great is our God.
Presenting Songs for Worship 50. 50 songs in one specially priced collection. You'll hear 50 beautiful songs of hope.
I'm coming back to the fire of worship. And it's
50 powerful songs of faith.
Maybe love will help.
Get Songs for Worship 50 on 3 CDs for only
$24.99. Here I am to worship. Here I am.
But wait. Order in the next 10 minutes with your credit card, and we'll take $15 off. That's right. You get 50 praise and worship songs for just
$9.99.
Then preview other great praise and worship collections. Satisfaction guaranteed.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
So call now and get Songs for Worship 50. 50 beautiful songs on 3 CDs for just
$9.99.
Call 1-800-735-7412 to order Songs for Worship 50 on 3 CDs for $9.99 plus shipping and handling when you use your credit card. Call now or order online at timelife.com/songsforworship50.
They say when your feet hurt, everything hurts. And Glenda Johnson would agree with that. Glenda's heels hurt so much that she had to walk on her tiptoes. Until early one morning, the pain disappeared.
The pain was very, excruciating pain. It would hurt basically all day until almost bedtime. Well, most of the time in the morning, I tiptoe. Because the heels hurt so bad, I just kind of tiptoed through the house, kind of holding on to balance myself. I never had the pain before, so I really knew it hurt, but I didn't know, you know, what to do about it. I watch 700 Club every morning, and this particular morning I was in the bed just finishing up my time with the Lord, and Pat Robertson was on television and he was talking.
There are people who have spurs, bone spurs in their bodies, and they're painful and they hurt. In the name of Jesus, we speak the word right now that those bones will knit together.
So I'm like, Lord, that's for me, my feet killing me. Father, if you can do anything with these feet, please, Lord, heal them. And so I just kind of leaned over and laid hands on my feet. I woke up one morning and I walked to the bathroom, and on my way to the bathroom, I realized, oh, I said, no pain, no pain, praise God, it worked, I'm healed. Right now, I'm free to jump out of the bed and get to running. I don't have to worry about tippy-toeing everywhere and grabbing onto things. And of course, I can bike ride now. We can go walking now. And so I basically can do everything I did before my feet started bothering me, everything. I am thankful every day, and I don't ever take my healing for granted. Every morning, when I touch the floor, I say, thank you, Father. I can walk.
I can walk. That is a great testimony. That can happen to you. That can happen to you. Whatever your need, realize that Jesus is the answer. He is the answer to every human need. Now, we're going to pray for you. We're going to pray with you. Just a few minutes. Before we pray, we want to encourage you with some wonderful stories. Here's Mary from Alabama. I don't know how you pronounce that. Opakilla, I guess. I'll try. Alabama, having constant roaring sound in her ears, her doctor could find nothing wrong and said she was going to have to live with it. Last month, she was watching the 700 Club. Terry, you had a word of knowledge. There's someone, you've got a problem in your ears. It's not a clogged ear or an infection. You have a constant ringing in your ears. It's so annoying. God is healing that for you right now. Put your hand over both of your ears and receive his power as he touches your eardrums and your inner ear. Well, Mary did that, and the roaring noise stopped. And hasn't
praise
come back.
God. Isn't that wonderful? God's so good. This is Ron. He lives in Lindale, Texas. He injured his right shoulder 4 years ago in an accident, had four different surgical procedures to correct that injury. And although he returned to his job as a long-distance truck driver, he still had pain in the shoulder. Then, last October, he parked his semi for the night. He had a little portable television and was channel surfing before going to sleep. He came across the 700 Club just as the hosts were giving words of knowledge. And Gordon, you said God was healing someone who had injured their right shoulder. Ron said he felt heat radiating through his shoulder and then regained a full range of motion for the first time in years. He's still amazed that God healed him on the road.
God can heal you on the road. He can heal you at home. He can heal you anywhere. What does it take? It takes you believing. Jesus says it very clearly, very clearly. Have faith in God. Don't have faith in anything else. It's not faith in your ritual or method or anything like that. Just have faith in God. Then believe that you have already received and you will have it. So right now, we're going to join hands. You join with us. In an act of faith, lay your hand on that area of the body that needs healing. And we'll agree, and we'll believe that you've already received, and then God will do the rest. Pray with us. Mm-hmm. Lord God, we just lift the knees of the audience to you right now, and as people are laying hands on the area of the body that needs healing, we just join into agreement with them, and we just come into agreement, touching. And we say, be healed and be made whole. There's someone, you heard the story about the ringing ears. You've had an operation on your left ear, and you're just asking God to stop the pain. It's just been in pain, and you're saying, can you just stop the pain? You're not believing for a total restoration. God's got a word for you that even though the surgeon has taken out parts of your the anvil and the stirrup and all those other things that are responsible for healing your inner ear, he's going to restore it all, and he is going to heal you, and you're going to be able to hear through that left ear again. There's a man, you're laying hands on your right hip, you're facing surgery, and you're saying, can God heal this so I don't have to go through the surgery? The answer for you is yes. And so in your right hip right now, he's just remaking it. He's taking out all those deposits, and he's reforming the cartilage that and all the fluid so that you have fluid motion, and it's not going to be pain. Get up and do what you couldn't do before, and just realize you've got a tremendous miracle because you've got a new hip socket.
Someone else, you have that same anxiety about surgery. You have some kind of a malformation of your jawbone, and they want to correct it with surgery, but you just don't have peace about it. God is going to heal that condition for you right now, in Jesus' name.
There's someone else, you've got a lot of pain when you have movements, and God is just going to take that away from you right now, in Jesus' name. Be healed and be made whole. In the name of Jesus. If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report, so give us a call. 1-800-759-0700. God bless.
While Mary feeds her two young daughters, she also helps feed needy families around the world. While Bob hands a drink out to a coworker, he helps give water to villages with new wells. And while Carl builds a house for his son's new puppy, he helps rebuild homes in disaster areas.
These people all have something in common. They're CBN partners who have joined Pledge Express. It's easy to sign up.
Just give us a call, log on to CBN.com, or return the Pledge Express form you receive in the mail. Then each month we'll send you Power for Life, and you'll receive this powerful CD called Overcoming Stress. So join us and change the world for someone today.